We are going live now, okay? So please speak accordingly.
Thank you, sir.
Rajkumar, thanks a lot.
Welcome, sir. Welcome, sir.
Sir, could you please make Richa the host as well? Because she had used the panelist link, but it said it wasn't working.
Yeah, having only one host control.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
Welcome, sir. Welcome, sir. I'll make Richa the host. I don't have to give the control to her, right? I can have two hosts at the same time.
I know, sir. I just said make her the panelist. That's it.
Rajkumar. We are also.
Yeah, sir. Yes,
we are getting the echo, yard. Echo of the streaming. Is it only me who is hearing the echo?
No, sir. Even we are.
Sir.
Yes, all of us can hear the echo.
No, sir,
close the YouTube link which you have been running behind your screen.
Sir, we aren't running.
No, maybe one of us is running. I don't know who is running.
No, sir, not.
Is it okay now? It was.
Yeah, it's okay, sir.
It was okay, actually.
Oh, okay. So, who is in charge of the streaming now? Richa? Yeah, sorry, Manvi.
No, sir.
Actually, it is from my system running up. Anyone can log in the YouTube and can have to take the.
Okay. Rajkumar, agar aap rahoge, agar hame koi bhi zarurat hai, even if you are not actively there, but
yeah,
you know, like.
I'm there, sir. No issues. I'll share the YouTube link to the in the chat box. Please give me share to anyone you wish to.
Okay. Thank you.
Sneha, wo bhi share kar lijiye. Theek hai? You can share it in all the groups.
Yes,
so people
sir.
Can even join, log in without registering and all.
Yes, sir.
And also on our Facebook and Instagram, wherever.
Yes, sir. Muskan, please do it on Facebook.
Yeah, I'll do both. I'll do on Facebook as well and on Instagram as well.
We have an admission committee meeting going on. Maybe that's why Jaini ma'am, we were all there. Jaini ma'am is still there.
Sneha, who's going to be the host?
But if, sir, if you remove yourself from the host, then the streaming will still continue.
Yeah, streaming will continue, I guess. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Maybe you can make me the host. I'll handle everything. Thank you, sir.
Now. You are the host now.
Thank you, sir.
So, Sneha, are we ready to get started?
I guess.
Yes, ma'am. The participants are still joining.
Okay.
Please request all our students to join on both the groups.
Yes, sir.
क्लास में नहीं हूँ और इंटरनेट डाउन हो गया इस तरह से आया हूँ डिपार्टमेंट में वो इवेंट डिपार्टमेंट पे तो ये मतलब ये स्टार्ट होने वाला है अभी इट विल स्टार्ट इन 5 मिनट्स
स्नेहा मुस्कान देयर इज नथिंग फ्रेश पोस्टेड ऑन जेस्ट ग्रुप
अच्छा रहा इवेंट और
यस मैम
जस्ट अ मिनट
There is no link shared, Sneha.
Yes, ma'am. I'm just sharing it right now. Actually, in the class group, someone was asking for the link. So I was just sending it to them. I'll send it on Zest as well.
Okay.
It is also showing live on YouTube.
YouTube link, the chat, it cannot be shared.
Ma'am, pardon? Which link?
On the YouTube link. The YouTube link that you have shared.
Yes, ma'am. I'll just copy paste it over there. I mean, on the Zest page and as well as the Zest WhatsApp group.
Seems like a new link because this one is not accepting any chat. The one that you had shared before.
Yes, ma'am, I think so.
So kindly share the new link.
Yes, ma'am.
Neha, are you using the MacBook or Windows laptop?
Just Windows laptop, sir.
What?
Sir, the Windows laptop, HP.
Fine, okay. Once the event starts, Neha, please start recording, okay? I don't have access to
record. Yes, sir. Sir, shall we begin the event?
depends on you, please.
Yes, sir. So, Rohit, sir, can we begin the event?
Yeah, I think we can begin. We can start.
Yes, sir. I hope I'm visible as well as audible.
Yes, you are.
Thank you, sir. Okay, let's begin. A very good morning, everyone. Hello, am I still audible?
You are audible, Sneha.
Sorry, ma'am. Good morning, everyone. I, Sneha R., the president of ZEST, the Department of English, Deen Dayal Upadhyaya College, University of Delhi, welcome you all to the second section of the ZEST Lecture Series 2021, Post-Pandemic World, From Pandemonium to Paradise. And who do we have here? Is it Butterfingers again? Of course, it's his creator, Professor Kairan Issa A. She's a fascinating personality, so I'm a little confused as to how to introduce her. Let's see. Let's start with the title, shall we? The Adventures of Butterfingers, From Academic to Pandemic and Beyond. Academic. So she's a retired professor of English from All Saints College, Trivandrum, and her students love her. And she was also writing in the column on classics for the Indian Express and the fortnightly humor column in The Hindu. The Adventures of Butterfingers started in 2006 with a popular children's magazine called Tinkle. So here it is, one of my most prized copies of Tinkle, and it has Butterfingers Lucky 600. So here is Butterfingers for you. So the interesting fact is, here the number 600 is lucky for Butterfingers. While in the new book, Smash It Butterfingers, ma'am addresses the superstition behind the number 13. Right, ma'am?
Yeah,
so, and in 2010, Butterfingers found an identity of his own when How's That Butterfingers was published by Puffin, followed by a series of novels, with the recent one being Smash It Butterfingers. Probably she wants Butterfingers to smash the coronavirus pandemic. She has published other books like The Lizard of Oz and Other Stories, which is an award-winning novel, and an adult book called Tongue in Cheek, The Funny Side of Life. She won the UNICEF Children's Fiction Award and has 5 children's books trust prizes to her credit. Before proceeding further, I would like to paraphrase my experience of Butterfingers in a sentence. When I was 7, unfamiliar still to the world of books, my cousin came in one day with Butterfingers and bestowed on me the gift which I cherish till now. So much so that all of the train rides, hours of adventure and fights with my cousins come back afresh and I become a child once more. And this is after the 7-year-old me thought that Butterfingers meant sponging our fingers with butter. So here is one more collection of mine. It's a poster of the 600th edition. Here is Butterfingers for you here, right here. So welcome you wholeheartedly, ma'am. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you, ma'am. I would like to warmly welcome our teacher in charge, Dr. Rohit P. and the other faculty members. I would like to warmly welcome all the attendees of today's lecture. So before proceeding further, I would like to just paraphrase what ZEST is in one sentence, because people might be asking us, I mean, what is ZEST? So ZEST for us embodies the principles of academics, scholarship, and brilliance. So before beginning the event, I would like to familiarize you with a few rules which are to be followed. So this program would be recorded and it's being streamed live on the ZEST YouTube channel. And you're requested to maintain the discipline decorum of the event. And if you have any questions, you may please put them in the chat box. They'll be addressed later during the Q&A session in the end. And a feedback form would be distributed at any time during the lecture. And you're also supposed to enter the details as you want them in the certificate. So what are we waiting for? Let's dive into the world of Butterfingers with butter in our hands and smiles in our faces. With this, I would like to hand over the podium to Professor Kairan Issa A. Ma'am, please.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Sneha. So
Dr. Rohit, teacher in charge, Dr. Paramesh, Dr. Anubhav, Dr. Lalit, they were the ones who were introduced to me, other members of the faculty, Sneha, very nice name you have, you're a very loving person, Sneha, the president of ZEST, all the students and whoever has joined in. Thank you. Good morning to you. And thank you very much, ZEST, for your zestful invitation. I'm extremely happy to be part of your lecture series. So thank you, Sneha, for all those warm, kind things you said about Butterfingers and how Butterfingers has been, butter has been dripping from your hands from age 7 and you have not let go of butter. Butterfingers means you having a slip grip and dropping things. I'm happy that you have not dropped Butterfingers. You have held on to Butterfingers so much so that you have actually invited me here to talk to your to everyone here who is part of ZEST of the Department of English of Deen Dayal Upadhyaya College, University of Delhi. It is my pleasure to be here with you. So we're looking at the title and whatever it has. I was just looking at the general title that you have given to the series, Post-Pandemic World from Pandemonium to Paradise. Right, so that is your title. And I was wondering, post-pandemic world is a little optimistic because we are still in the pandemic world. We have not gone to the post part yet. And from pandemonium sounds rather Miltonic, pandemonium to paradise. Are we heading for paradise or are we heading for an inferno? I hope it is paradise and not inferno. And also for me, you have said from academic to pandemic and beyond and exploring the world of children's literature, how literature can help us cope in this post-pandemic world. Well, anyway, as I told you, the pandemic hasn't ended yet for us to think of a post-pandemic world. And therefore, I'm happy with the optimism of this lecture series. You are really hopeful and it's very nice that you are so hopeful because not everybody is. But I think you're also hopeful because we can see a light at the can't even see a proper light. You can say a speck, a fleck, a glimmer at the end of the tunnel that we are hoping will become a beacon of light. This is at the end of the corona tunnel. So the thing is that we are now living in a new era, an unprecedented era. You can say the pandemic age. We have had all kinds of ages, the Paleolithic age, the Neolithic age, then you have the geological Triassic age, your Jurassic age, all these ages. And now we have the pandemic age, the pandemic era. It isn't that the world is not used to the idea of a pandemic. In the 14th century, we had the plague, the great plague that plagued everybody. And it was terrible. In fact, that nursery rhyme, Ringa Ringa Roses, it was actually created with all the characteristics of the plague in mind. So now you have children singing that song and Ringa Ringa Roses running round and round and jumping Ringa Ringa Roses, pocket full of posies, Husha Usha all fell down and they are so happy. What it is talking about is when you have plague, you have a kind of, there's a pattern that develops on your skin, which looks like a ring of roses. Roses brought here for something so grotesque and so ghastly and so terrible. Ringa Ringa Roses, pocket full of posies. You know how people were very superstitious in those days and now too. And they used to have posies in their pocket. They believed that if you have posies in your pocket, you can ward off the plague. One of those things, you know, you cling on to anything at such times. Husha Usha is actually a tissue. You sneeze when you have, this is one of the symptoms of the bubonic plague, and all fell down dead. That is what it was. All fell down dead, and you have these little children rushing around, husha, husha, all fell down. You don't realize that this particular nursery rhyme started at such a time. So then the plague was there in Italy and some European countries, and then you had it coming again and again. But the difference here is that now we are living in a global village. At that time, we were not quite sure where exactly there was this plague, how much it had spread, where all it has spread to, and so on. But now it is, now that we pride ourselves on calling ourselves the world a global village, instant communication. See, you are in Delhi, I'm in Trivandrum. We can see each other, we can listen to each other, we can have a program where all of us are involved in. So these are the miracles, you can say, scientific miracles that have taken place from the 14th century, if you look at it, to the 21st century. But so what has happened is we know that this is a global phenomenon, that corona has spread everywhere, to every corner of the earth. So just as communication is so easy for us to go from one place to the other, we have taken this virus from one place to the other at an amazing speed. If it makes us happy, if it makes us comfortable, we are all in this together. I don't know whether you can feel consoled by the thought, but for me, I feel good that it's not just India that is suffering. It's not just one part of the world that is suffering, whether it is first world, third world. In fact, in the beginning, it was the first world countries that were having so many deaths happening. So everyone is involved. So why can't we give this name, this particular age, a kind of name? Shall we call it BC, not BCE, before common era, but BC in the sense of before corona, before COVID. Let's have a BC, and then let's have a DC. During corona, which is the period we are in now. And hopefully there will be an AC after corona, when I suppose you can happily have AC going on in your rooms. Now AC is kind of, it's suspect. AC is one of the reasons why corona spreads, they say. So all the creature comforts that we had have suddenly become something that we are looking at pretty suspiciously. So let's hope that during will soon give way to after corona. So what has corona done to our lives? I know that we all know this, but I'm just, you know, kind of quickly telling you what it has done. It has held the world to ransom. It has brought in wonderful things like what? Lockdown, social distancing, masks, hand sanitizing. And when you look at it, every country has its defense in place. Every country is very alert for any kind of military attack. Everything is there. But what do you do when you are at war with a germ? Whoever believed that a germ would come and kind of rush around and capture the whole world? So the doctors, earlier it was left to the doctors to take care of germs. A small section, here is an epidemic. Here is something happening. Doctors will take care of it. We will take care of other things. And then this COVID happened, too huge for people to ignore. Everybody got sucked in. So it brought the world to a grinding halt, and everyone had to give this attention. The first lockdown was, in a sense, rather exciting, I would say. Actually, anything new is. So you thought, oh, lockdown sounds nice. Let us all sit at home. Children were very happy. Students were thrilled. Finally, you know, you don't have to go to school. You don't have to go to college. This is college. This is school. We are sitting at home. How we clamored for holidays. How we scanned the newspaper every morning to see if somebody is, if there is a holiday declared. Somebody, even when somebody dies, the first thing that comes to your mind is holiday. And I'm sorry, but that's how children are. And so that is how we looked at everything. And we thought, okay, fine. We can sit at home. Long holiday. The virus is out there. That was also very scary, mysterious. It's like a monster out there. Don't go out because the virus is out there. Don't speak to anyone. The virus can come there. Don't socialize with anyone. Don't visit people. Don't allow visitors. Don't. We became so paranoid, so very suspicious, so antisocial. Like Godot says, you know, like in Waiting for Godot, nothing happens. No one comes. No one goes. It's awful. So finally, we realized it was awful. In the beginning, the novelty was there. But a little later, it kind of got a little too much. The screen became our refuge. Our phone became God. It was taking care of everything. And people began to find ways and means to survive. And one thing I found out is that, which you also must have found out, we don't really need many of the things in life. We are so acquisitive. We want this, we want that, forever buying clothes. What for? We don't really need so many clothes. We realize that we don't really need half the things that we clutter our homes with. The corona has taught us a lot of meaningful lessons, which I hope we will take with us, we will keep with us and not forget once we go to the after corona times. I love the idea that weddings have become small. I love the idea that there isn't any ostentation in weddings. I love the idea that there is no extravagance happening. So those are little things, not little things. These were things that mattered for me. And I was very happy that this has happened, but I was not happy with the way it happened, that you needed a virus to come and teach you these kind of life lessons. Anyway, whatever. And then the lipstick. I think the commodity that went totally out of need was the lipstick. When you're wearing a mask all the time, what is the need for a lipstick? So there it is. The lipstick is thrown out of the window. So then we entered a new age where we are always masked. Earlier, children used to wear masks when they want to pretend to be Superman, Batman, all those, He-Man, all those. And now they're just, their father, a man, is just not a He-Man, is wearing a mask. They are wearing masks. Everyone is wearing masks. Now, it's such a time when things were getting to us. So after a little while, it was getting to be a little too much. Imagine everybody cooped up in the house and not really happy with one another. Everyone said, now we have family time. And then we hear about family squabbling. You know, they're too much of a good thing or a bad thing. And you find all kinds of things happening. Then we have shops and everything closed down. And we have suicides related to people losing jobs. People are laid off. So many unfortunate things were happening. And at such a time, you need something to keep you going. And I think the two things that can keep us going, one is books. Books can keep you going. Books are very, very important. Books have always been important. We didn't need Corona to come and tell us how important it is to have books in the house, not just have as a kind of a show, but read books. You know, your house without books is like a house without books is like a house without windows, they say. So that is how, that's something that gave us solace. And then humor, so important. We really need humor to look at things in the proper perspective. We really need humor to make us understand, to deflate our egos, to make us understand that we are very insignificant. We need humor to laugh. We need humor to release the endorphins, which will de-stress us. We need to get de-stressed. Everybody was stressed out, sitting at home and not knowing what to do. The uncertainty, when will this come to an end? When will this come to an end? And then we had the second wave, which was horrible. And then now we have people expected a third wave that has thankfully not come yet. But I really don't know, because I'm a little horrified at the casualness with which people are handling Corona now. You find a lot of people not bothered about wearing masks. There are a lot of people mixing, coming together and having parties are coming back. So it's a little scary, because I think we shouldn't be foolhardy. We have done it once. We shouldn't do it again until it is really conquered, until almost everyone is vaccinated, until we are sure that we have really attacked and, as Neha says, smashed the virus out of contention. We have to be very careful. But then, so what I was just looking at what people wanted post-pandemic. Anyway, you were talking about post-pandemic paradise, right? So what is exactly do people want post-pandemic? What are the things they are craving for? All right. And these were the findings. Very interesting. But I'm sure you will probably agree with most of them. Topping the list is drinking at pubs and socializing. Okay. Drinking at pubs. They're not able to go to pubs, not able to drink. Very, very frustrating for people who love their beer. Then festivals. And people want festivals because festivals are times which they're not excuses. They're times when everybody gets together, when you have a wonderful time, when there is dancing, singing, eating together, so many things happening. Then live concerts. People want to, we have had enough of music, we have had enough of movies with Netflix and so on. We can watch all that. But no, you want to go out there. You want to be with that. This is a special feeling, no? To be part of a live concert when you are enjoying it and so many others are enjoying it. That itself makes you feel so much better. It gives you such great joy. So you want to go for live, to attend live performances. Next, pampering. Pampering and beauty therapy. People have not been able to go for haircuts. See, I cut my hair on my own, and it's good that you cannot see the back of my head because then you'll be horrified at how it is. So people have not, beauty parlors have been kicked out of existence, almost temporary existence, hopefully. And people are waiting to pamper themselves, to go and get a facial, enjoy themselves when someone else does everything for them, you know, to have the Turkish bath, whatever it is, sauna and things like that. Go to the gym. People want to go to the gym and be fit. not much fun doing, you know, the dumbbells and stuff like that at home. You want to be with others, want to watch others sweat. Like somebody said, I want to get the smell of another person's sweat. I really don't think, you know, one should go that far. Neither do I think it is a great craving. But you so want company of others that is something that they want. Then travel. Everyone wants to travel. And travel just like that. Tomorrow I would like to go somewhere. Book tickets, not have an RT-PCR test, not have your boarding pass and everything done and go crazy getting ready for a short trip, but just book your ticket and go where you want to go, travel, enjoy yourself that way. After that comes seeing loved ones. I was wondering why seeing loved ones comes so much, you know, somewhere in the middle. Probably it is because you are already seeing them. In your home, you are seeing your loved ones, but you're not seeing them all. Some people are separated. There are people who have not been able to meet one another because of corona. Then you want to meet your friends. You may be talking to them. You may be on screen having these kind of sessions and meetings and so on, but nothing like physically being there, talking over a cup of coffee and so on. So you want that. Sporting events. People want to go and watch sports. And I was surprised that this time at the US Open, there were so many people watching it. It was almost like the old times. And even the cricket match, I found a lot of people in the England, the test matches that happened. So things are opening up, but it is in a limited way. And everyone wants to go and be there as part of a crowd and see that your team wins. So sporting events, people are missing. Then the outdoors, walking, hiking, going to the beach, going to the park. We crave the outdoors. And outdoors is a nice place to be in during corona times because that is the time when that's the least infectious place. Eating out. People want to eat out. You're eating at home. You're having food brought in, but nothing like going to a restaurant, waiting for hours. And in fact, I saw a nice cartoon which said, there's this man sitting grumpily at the table and the waiter brings the food and he tells him, why didn't you send me a card while you were away? Meaning he took that long to bring the order that was placed probably 2 hours back. But it is all part of eating out. Then there is this interesting, no changes. They don't want any changes. They're quite happy at how things were. Corona was fine. Lockdown was fine. Being alone in your own company, reading the books you want to read, eating on your own, watching movies, playing video games. There are people who quite like that, who have fallen into this pattern and are quite pleased with that. And then there is something called, which I think is a very important thing. There is a kangaroo care. See, what happens is a kangaroo has the baby because in its pouch, because the baby is not yet fully developed. And that skin-to-skin contact is what helps the baby get to be healthy when the baby is in the pouch. So kangaroo care actually means, you know, physical contact. Humans also need that, not just the kangaroo. We want to hug. We want to shake hands when we meet. That's what we do. But all that is not happening. Maximum you do is do this. You know, it's you're not, no touch, not touching, no touching scenes, all right? Nobody touches one another. Nobody hugs. Nobody kisses. I mean, outside. So anyway, so that is there, which we need. And then there is this retail therapy, going and wasting money in the shop. You kind of what you call comfort shopping. Go and shop just because you feel comfortable shopping. So here it is. And look at that no change group. No one else said we want to read. So your topic was how can, what role can Butterfingers and what role can books play in the post-pandemic world? I would say that they will only play the role they have always been playing. They have been playing before the pandemic, during the pandemic, after the pandemic. It is the same role that they are going to play, all right? And nobody said we want to read books because that is happening. Nobody said we want to enjoy books because they're already enjoying books. So this no change thing is very telling because they want to continue as they are, because books have always been there. If there is retail therapy, we have intellectual therapy. We really need books in order to give us a kind of boost. So emotionally, what has happened is Corona has hit the world hard. And this is where books come in. This is where humor comes in. And this is where probably Butterfingers, tongue-in-cheek, these kind of books come in. Because humor is the coping tool for survival, especially during tough times. But what they say is, if you don't have a natural propensity for humor, if you are the kind who always, you know, the stiff upper lip, you don't find anything funny, it's time you let your guard down. Time you realize that life is not that serious. Time you realize that you should be able to laugh at things. Don't take yourself so seriously. Laugh at yourself. There are lots of things. In fact, my tongue-in-cheek is all about laughing at myself because I find there's so much to laugh at about me. So I might make myself the subject of all those disasters, those misfortunes, those fun, humorous misadventures that are there. So actually, laugh, it's a coping tool for survival, you can say. And it is something that brings us together. Shared laughter is very good. You want to be with others when you laugh. You that's why in a party, this is one of a, it's an icebreaker. Someone cracks a joke and everybody laughs. And then they start talking to one another. So that's what laughter does to us. It makes us stronger. And mentally too, it de-stresses you. It actually releases endorphins that help the brain lighten your mood and your spirits. And they also boost our dopamine levels, even shore up our immune system. See, so many good things for us. But what I would like to say is, don't, just like, you know, when people ask me, what does reading do to you? Why should my son read? They ask me. And then I tell them, you must read for fun. The child must enjoy himself. And the mothers are not, and fathers are not particularly happy because they want their child only to study hard and be first in class. So they want to know, what will reading do? In what way will it help my child? For me, the child must love reading a book. The joy of reading is an end in itself. You know, that's how it is. But no, they want something specific. Then I tell them, okay, your child's language will improve. Grammar will improve. Your sentence construction will improve. Logical way of looking at things will improve. Your comprehension, the child's comprehension will improve. Then they feel slightly better. And then when I finally tell them that research has proved that reading books actually makes long-term changes to your brain, your long-term memory improves because it's a sedate activity. Because of that, your child will become very successful. He will be They will be, I'm including women too, because I'm stop using he, they will be achievers. All right, achievers. You should see the joy on the faces of the parents when they hear the word achiever. My child will become an achiever by reading books. I don't know whether after they, when they go back home and they recall whether they are still happy with my, whatever I told them, but I was happy that I was able to convince them, and it's the truth. I did not, talk through my hat. I was just non-existent. I was just telling them that this is what will happen. So similarly, laughter also does a lot. But laugh because it makes you feel good. Don't laugh because your this will happen. This will be okay. Your immune system will be okay. You will get better. This, that, and so on. Those will happen anyway. But you laugh. Enjoy yourself. So then, coming to Butterfingers, I was wondering how Amar and his cool Green Park would have coped with the quarantine. I was just thinking, how would Amar, who is such an outdoor person, he's 13 years old, he is a student of Green Park Higher Secondary School, he is in class 8, full of beans, wants to be out playing all the time. Often in trouble, gets into trouble, gets out of trouble in the same way, has a lot of wacky friends with him. How would this boy manage a lockdown? How would this boy sit at home? Will you have to tie him up? You know, what would he be doing? How would he take to online teaching? Not that he would cares much for offline teaching, but he will have to do that anyway. So then, I was just thinking, this first book, my first book, House at Butterfingers, if it is during lockdown, that book cannot happen at all. The book is about an inter-school cricket tournament that has been arranged. So you find that they need to go out and practice. They need to go out and play. So that is what is happening all the time. If you can't go out, what do you do? Half my book is gone. The other concern is that they are going to lose their playground. The school is going to lose its playground. Imagine a school without a playground. Children are very happy if they say it's a school without teachers. But you tell them there's a school without a playground, and then you can see how they will react. No. Playground is so important. And now there is nobody in the playground. You don't need a playground. So here you have a greater part of the book concerned about how to see that they do not lose the playground. And now, if it was lockdown, there it is. You don't have a playground. You don't need a playground. You don't need a school. You don't need games, physical games. You can play cricket online. You can do all kinds of things. So I'm just thinking, my books will have no meaning. The next one is Gold Butterfingers, where Amar has these wonderful ideas, all right? All, and his friends tell him, all your ideas take us to one place, and that is the principal's room. But anyway, that doesn't stop Amar from going, coming up with another idea. And he will never say, I have an idea. He'll always say, I have a brilliant idea. I have a super idea. I have an awesome idea. You know, he's very certain his ideas are wonderful. But his ideas are. And never mind that they land him in trouble and his friends and detention and all kinds of things. You know who their very favorite person is? The peon in the principal's room. Because they spend so much time in the principal's room, they have become great friends. And it's nice to have a person who is in the principal's room as your friend. You get to know a lot of things before other people do, right? So that is how they operate. And in the second book, you have him planning a World Cup tournament, a World Cup in school. You imagine having a World Cup in school. Someone says, no, we can have it. 8A, 8B, 9A, 9B will take on the names of football playing countries, and we will have a World Cup. All right. But then there is a mysterious English teacher who comes to their school. And this teacher doesn't know how to laugh. All right. She's one of those, you know, who takes life too seriously. She just can't even smile. She looks so grim. She's so formidable. And she looks like she's been sucking on a lime all the time. She's got that kind of an expression. Therefore, these children call her Sour Puss. Sourpuss is their nickname. Now that also cannot happen if it is lockdown, because what do you do unless you're with your friends together and see somebody and see how they behave? How do you come up with these kind of names and so on? So I was thinking of how, and then there's a pesticide factory coming up, a lot of complications. The third book, Clean Bowl Butterfingers, it actually centers around the principal saying, the director, who is very unhappy because a lot of teachers are applying for medical leave. He says, what is this? He asks the principal. All your teachers are so unfit, forever asking for medical leave. You must make them fit. They must be active. They must play sports. See that they play sports. The teachers are most unhappy and distressed. What is this? Now they are asking us to play games. So let them go and play. And he says there must be a match. Now that also cannot happen. So I was just thinking of how it is with Butterfingers and what he would do. But I do know that had Butterfingers been living during, I mean, had it been lockdown times, Butterfingers will find a way out of this. He will evolve his own plans. He will see that he and his friends, he will see that they still have games. He will invent new games. He will see that they keep themselves occupied. He will see that, and he will still create a lot of problems, maybe for his parents and so on. He will still be butterfingered. He will still be clumsy. He will still carry disaster with him. He will still be accident prone. He will be all these things. And we can still have a good laugh with him, at him and at his antics. So I seriously think that laughter will really, really, really help you, and it will be wonderful if you read books. Reading books itself is therapeutic. Reading humorous books will really make you feel better, will make you feel you can take on anything, will make you handle the pandemic much better than anything else can. Even your counseling that person might be asked to go for because they are feeling depressed. If they read something humorous and get lost in humor and laugh, I think that will do much better for them than someone telling you how to live life and what to do and so on, which is very necessary, of course. But when you keep reading books, you will learn how to live life. You see how many people are living what kind of lives. You see how they, you see the pitfalls of life. You get a vicarious experience of different people's lives. You really enjoy even people's sufferings, because that's what they say about books, right? Aristotle's, that famous, about catharsis and so on. Why do we enjoy tragedy? Primarily because it's not happening to you. it's got a cathartic effect. It's happening to somebody else. So the kind of relief, okay, it's not happening to me. But for the grace of God, go we. You know, it is happening to somebody else. We know how it happens. And you're completely involved in that. But finally, the cathartic feeling is that something has got resolved, whether it was through tragic means. It must be through tragic means because it's a tragedy. But we are unaffected by it because it did not directly happen to us, but we are affected by it because it has done something to our minds. It has changed our minds. Every book changes us. That's the beauty of a book. Whether it is a fiction, it's a fiction or non-fiction, every book changes us, which is why you studying literature, you in this University of Delhi and wherever you are, we have no excuses for not reading books. Another person might say, we don't like reading. I would say that nobody has any excuse for not reading books. But if you are a student of literature, we have absolutely no excuse for not reading. And reading way beyond our syllabus, not confining ourselves only to syllabus alone. And reading diverse kind of books so that all of them help you change. Change for the better. Help your mind grow. Help you become wonderfully adjusted people. Like I told that parent, you will all become achievers, right? You will all become highly successful, hugely successful. You'll all become achievers, happy people, successful people, people who will make the change. All right. So thank you, Sneha. You told me that you wanted a longer session for question and answers. So I think I will stop here and ask you to take over from here.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was really a humorous explanation of, I mean, the pandemic, post-pandemic. I mean, added with it the elements of literature which you weaved in. It was really good. We have a surprise for you. I mean, oh. Yeah, actually, Pavan from our department,
yeah,
he writes good haiku. So he wrote a haiku for you.
Oh my God. Okay.
I'll just present it.
Okay.
Yeah, so this is it. My name is spelled wrong and it's written often. Butterfingers is well known. Let's meet on online platform.
Thank you. Thank you very much. You got it.
My name is...
Yes. My name is spelled wrong often. Butterfingers is well known. Let's meet on online platform. Yes. And I hope someday I will meet you actually offline. Yeah, thank you so much. Who? What's the name of the boy you said who wrote this?
Pavan Kumar.
Pavan, yes, Pavan. Thank you very much for these three lines of haiku. First time I'm ever put into a haiku. All right, so it's a very special occasion for me. Thank you. Yeah, and my name is spelled wrong forever. It is something that I have learned to live with. It is spelled wrong and pronounced wrong also. All right. So see, sometimes I feel like Pi in, you know, the life of Pi who goes and writes on the board. This is how you have to spell my name, his full name, you know, because it's very close to something else. So to see that you spell it correctly, pronounce it correctly. So often that is what happens for me, but I've learned to live with it. Doesn't matter. You know, this is how it is. And as long as it sounds a little like my name, then I'm fine. In fact, when I was in college and there used to be someone coming to meet a teacher, and then they stand there and stammer and stutter, everyone will turn to me. I'm sure they're sure it's for me, you know, because someone hasn't been able to pronounce the name. So the only one in the department with this unpronounceable name is me. So it has to be me. They all turn to me. So that's how it is. Yeah. All right, Sneha.
Yes, ma'am. That anecdote was really good. It made us all laugh.
Ma'am, it also shows that your name is unique as well. So that's why it's very difficult for people to pronounce it. So I think it's a compliment.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, in fact, I was telling Sneha the other day how we have a teacher. He was a famous poet, Vishnu Narayana Nambudri. He passed away recently, and he's a very well-known Malayalam poet, but he taught us English. We had Old English for PG and he used to teach us Middle English. So I'm called, I have to let out a secret here now. I'm called Rosie at home. It's a pet name. For some reason, my sister, when she saw me as a baby, she said it is a rosy baby. I think by that analogy, I should be brownie now. But I was called Rosie. And so those who get to know me better, they find it much easier to call me Rosie than Khairunis. Anyway, one day, he heard someone called Rosie. So he turned, he looked around, there's no such person in the class. And someone else said, this is her pet name. And then he turned to me, looked very quizzical. I said, yes, very apologetic I was, and told him, yes, this is my pet name. I'm called this at home. And then he said, how can you, when you have such a beautiful, because he's a poet, all right? So for him, Khairunisa has a nice ring to it. Because you have such a beautiful poetic name, which also means very good. You know, my mother once said unique, it means one in a million. And when I told a friend, he asked, one what in a million? You know, so immediately that also goes. So anyway, so he said, when you have such a name, how can you allow yourself to be called by the name of a dog? So I said, that is how, which is constantly given to a dog. I said, anyway, so that's my name. I didn't even reply. I think I just smiled rather sheepishly. The doggishly. Yeah. So thank you. If you like my name, it needs a little bit of effort to pronounce it properly. But once you make that effort, as with everything, you don't forget easily because you have taken some pains over it. Yeah. Yes, Neha?
Another interesting anecdote, which is really really amazing. I mean, it's really humorous as well. So I think we'd move on to the question and answer session.
Okay. Huh? Yeah. Fine.
Yeah. So you can all drop in your your questions in the chat box. I'll give you the access to speak, so you can speak and ask the question. Let's start the Q&A session.
Yeah.
Okay. Fine. So I would like to start with my question. Actually, I had so Smash It Butterfingers was written during the pandemic.
Yes.
I think so, ma'am.
Yes,
so how did it feel that the pandemic was going around you, but then you had to write on something which was a pre-pandemic world, the world of Butterfingers? How did it feel? Was it difficult?
No, I really don't think that because you're writing during the pandemic world, you will write only about the pandemic. I don't think I've written anything about the pandemic, Sneha, so far. In fact, another book of mine that is coming out is a travel book. It's a second book for older readers, for adults. It's a nonfiction travel book where occasional mention is there of the pandemic, because I cannot help but make a comparison between what we experienced and what is happening now. Not that I'm doing it all the time, a stray reference here and there, but otherwise I did not. But one thing, what happened was that I had already signed the contract for Smash It Butterfingers, and it was supposed to have come out last year. Yes, 2019, I signed the contract. It was supposed to have come in September 2020, like our cricket. So, but because of the pandemic, everybody was badly hit, including publishers. So they were moving books. They were pushing books to a future date. Actually, I was quite pleased because I got more time to write, and the moment I heard this, you know what happened? I just stopped writing. Because yes, that's what happens. See, when you're writing under contract, you know, I'm not writing a book because I want to get it published and then selling it to publishers and so on. All my books, right from House at Butterfingers, have been written under contract, which means the contract tells you how many months you have to write the book. So you plan accordingly, because you already have a book in your head. You already have your edit. Your publishers know what the book is about before they send you the contract. They don't just send you a contract. They will see if your book is, you know, what the topic and how it is and so on before they do that. So they send this contract, and you plan your book. So when that happened, I just stopped writing, because I thought, okay, I've got so many more months to write. And at that time, my son and my daughter-in-law had come here, had come to India, and they got stuck because there was this travel ban. They're in the US. They couldn't go back. So I could devote a lot of time to them. I didn't have this, this book having to be finished in a particular time. I knew now, okay, I've got some more time to write. I can space it out and write it. So that was not a problem at all. So I didn't really, the pandemic only helped me write the book better, I think. It gave me a lot of, I did not have to go anywhere. I did not have any events, no weddings to attend, no functions to go for. I could sit at home and write my book, be with my family. So that, all that worked, I would say. But I was also affected by what was happening because of the pandemic, because it did not directly hit me, directly in the sense my immediate family, but in my mother's family in Chennai, about 10 relatives lost their lives to the pandemic, and one relative in Dubai. So 11 people died because of the pandemic. You cannot just ignore something like that. They are not all closely related. Three are, one is an aunt, one is a cousin, one's a cousin's husband, the others are all third cousins, you know, but related. So you have so many deaths happening, and all that affects you. And that is not quite the kind of scenario to write a humor book. So you get me? Because of this time that I had to submit my manuscript, I was able to, if I was not in the mood to write, then I just would not write, because I had a much longer time to write. So that was how I managed, Sneha, to write my book. And then by then it was time for me to give my manuscript, because they were planning it for August 2021. So I gave my manuscript by June, and that is it.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Yeah, we have one more question from Kirti Chaudhary. Kirti, you may speak now. And you can ask your question.
Yes, Kirti. Kirti Chaudhary is still muted, I think.
Yes, ma'am.
Neha, she has written the question in the chat box.
Yeah. Despite having a lot of areas in fiction writing, what inclined you towards children's fiction? What made you see yourself as a comic strip creator? I think she's referring to Tinkle.
Yes, yes, I know. I'm glad she almost asked what made you think of yourself as a comic character. No. So, Kirti, yes. Why I went into humor, it's all purely accidental, you could say. Well, about humor, I've always loved humor. I will always enjoy humor. I always had an inclination towards humor from the time I was a child when I was reading books. I used to read, I read widely, but I have a partiality towards humorous books. I have yen for humor books, and I discovered P.G. Woodhouse when I was in class 8 and have not stopped reading him. Now I own about 60 of his books. He's written about 100. I just love him, you know. You can read him at any time, and at home too. If you can the humor skills are honed when you belong to a large family. I'm one of seven siblings. I have seven siblings, of whom six are girls and one is a boy. Poor boy. He was the second eldest. So what happens is that always there is this back and forth happening. And being the youngest, you know, you can be crushed. So you always have to stand up for yourself. There will be retorts and reparties, and you're always trying to get the better of the other person. So you're on your toes linguistically, you could say, to try to say something in a humorous way, to retort in a humorous way, and so on. So all that helped hone my humor skills, you could say. It was happening without my being quite aware of it. But whenever we had to write something in school and in college, I always used to inject some humor in the writing. I always used to make it humorous. Even in essay writing and essays and articles, I always try to see that I bring in some humor. But how I happened to write a comic strip thing was totally accidental, because when my son was small, we used to get Tinkle at home. And they were asking, the inviting writers to enter, to send entries for the Tinkle short story competition for adult writers of children's fiction. So I thought, why not send a story? Because I never really wanted to become a writer. But when I saw that, I thought, why not send a story? And that story, the first story that I wrote, it is Butterfingers. The story's title was Butterfingers. I created this character Butterfingers then because I wanted to write a sports-based story. I love sports. I love cricket. So when you are entering a competition, though you say, I wrote it just like that. I wrote it for a lark. I just sent an entry. But when you're sending an entry for a competition, you want it to be good. You hope that what you're writing is not what another person might write. So I told myself, not too many people will be writing sports-based stories. Even now, you don't find too many sports-based books. So I will write a sports-based story. So I'll write a sports-based story. I will write a fun story, a humorous story. And then I thought of Butterfingers. Butterfingers is a name constantly used at home. It's not something that I created. It's been like there for a long time. Dickens has used it in Pickwick Papers. It has been there even before that. So we call one another Butterfingers when somebody drops something. So I thought, okay, if I'm going to write about cricket, it makes sense to have a Butterfingers on the cricket field. He can drop catches. He can, you know, make everybody so frustrated by his wonderful clumsy skills. So I thought I will have a Butterfingers, a boy who is nicknamed Butterfingers. So that's how I wrote that story, Butterfingers. But it went on to win a prize. And later on, Tinkle asked me to create a regular character for their magazine. By then, I was writing a few stories for them. And somehow Butterfingers has been a favorite character. He's been, can you could say, living in my head. And I said, I already have a character who is, have created a character. So this person, Luis Fernandez, who was the associate editor then, he was not there when my story was published. So he said, in that case, well, why don't you send two stories about Butterfingers? So I thought up two stories and I sent, and he liked them very much. He said, let's start Butterfingers as a series. Sneha, that's how you managed to read Butterfingers in Tinkle. And it became hugely popular. So you realize how it was totally accidental. I saw this and I wrote. And what happens in Tinkle is that it is a comic book. So though my writing is, it's long, my stories are long. The first story, they wanted it to be 3,000 words. And I think I must have written 2,999 words. And another person steps in, and that's a script writer. So you write the story. You could write your own script, but I don't have those script writing skills. Even otherwise, I just send the entry. They have their script writers who reduce, I should use the word reduce my long story into 8 or 9 pages of comic strip. It was heartbreaking when it first happened. Hello, where have all my wonderful sentences gone? Where has this gone? Where has that gone? Of course, the whole story is the same. Much, and because my books, if you have read them, they're all conversation driven. I use a lot of conversation in my books. So the script writers find it easy to script my stories because it's easy for them to write the script. It's all about conversation, right? Comic. Yet, I was very sad when it first came. Instead of being happy, okay, here is your story coming in print in comic strip form. I was sad that the best lines were not there and so on, but very quickly I understood that this is how it works. This is a new, this is a different genre. It's a different form altogether, and I understood. But I decided that is when this idea of probably having getting the longer version published, because the rights are with me, and the comic strip rights are with Tinkle. So I thought that I will publish it, and I didn't compromise on my writing style. I continued to write like that, because I have wanted to get them published. So that is how this comic strip character happened, Gitti. It was not deliberate at all, just because I sent an entry. And for a comic strip, it's not enough to just write the story. Three people are involved. The writer of the story, the script writer, and the very, very important person, the illustrator. Illustrator has a huge role to play. If the illustrators, he has to think up the character and draw the character according to how the writer has described. So actually, when Abhijit Kinney, he was the illustrator, the editor sent me what he has drawn of Butterfingers and asked me, is this okay? Can we go with this for Butterfingers? Because the first story, it happened, that was all long back. All right. So this is a new, the Butterfingers series coming after 10 years of that first story. So I said, nice, very nice, because the expression was very nice, just as I wanted Butterfingers to be. But his hair was brown. Abhijit had colored his hair brown. I said, no. So I told the editor sent it to me. So I told the editor, no, I don't want colored hair. I want black hair. This is my Indian boy and he must have black hair. Children all over India must be able to identify with this boy. So they asked the artist to change the color. Later on, Abhijit and I became friends. And then Abhijit asked me, told me one day, do you know what? I had made Butterfingers, and I told him how much I love Butterfingers. We went back to that. He said, they made it black. He was very indignant. He said, I had made his hair nice and brown, and that editor, he wanted it to be black. They didn't say that. I think that I wanted it to be made black. So then I very, in a very apologetic voice, I confessed that it was not the editor. Don't blame him. It was me. Or rather, to be very grammatically correct, it was I who said this. And then I told him this is the reason why. So that is how this comic thing happened. All right. So that is totally accidental. But as far as humor is concerned, yes, it has always been my desire to write humor.
Yeah, this is the, I think, if it's visible. I think this is Butterfingers. Yeah.
Yeah.
Black color.
Correct. In black hair. Yeah.
Yeah, black hair.
And look at his face. He does a beautiful job, Abhijit. I'm so happy with how he has got his expression, because I wanted Butterfingers to be endearing. At the same time, you know, that mischief should be there, that he should have, the people should feel affectionate towards him. He shouldn't look grumpy. He should be warm. He should be mischievous. He should be somebody that is adorable. It's a nice mix of everything that I had in my head, you know, because everyone likes him in spite of him taking disaster with him wherever he goes. And Abhijit got it beautifully, except for the hair. And y'all saw it as black hair. Only I saw it as brown hair. So when you see it, you will be happy with the way, I'm sure you will be happy with, you must be happy with how Butterfingers has been drawn. I would give a lot of credit to the success of, for the success of Butterfingers to Abhijit for his wonderful illustrations. That is why Penguin also asked him to illustrate the cover. So you have Abhijit drawing him on all the covers, where Butterfingers is a little different, slightly different in the sense, in the others, his hair is all over his forehead. In the books, you find his hair going back. There must be some difference, right? So that's how it is. Yeah.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I mean, it was really, hearing the story behind the creation was really inspiring.
We have one more question.
One more question? Okay.
Yes.
Pavishi? If she would like to speak, I mean, I'll just unmute her. If she isn't speaking, then we'll read from the...
Then you will speak. Okay.
Yeah. Tavishi?
Yeah. Where is she?
Yeah, she has unmuted.
Yeah. Tavishi Sharma. Yes, Tavishi.
Ma'am, I wanted to ask you that every author wants to establish their own identity, something which is very unique to them.
Yeah.
So how were you able to establish this identity, and was the process difficult?
Establish my identity in the sense that you want my books to be, you read a book and you know that this is written by me. It was not difficult because I was always writing for me. I think people associate humor with me. In fact, that you could say is my identity. I'm not saying that they will just, you will fall off the, or you'll roll on the floor with laughter with every line that you read and so on. But in general, even my books on animals, Lizard of Oz and other stories, The Crocodile Who Ate Butter Chicken for Breakfast, a long title, and other stories where you have all these creatures. I'm writing about small creatures. Okay. That's also funny. So humor is what you could say could be my defining characteristic. And I could say that I've been to a great extent successful, because in my book for older people also, in Tongue in Cheek too, I have written, it's humorous. In fact, people have been calling it, it's been doing very well. It's gone into the sixth print. People have been calling it the stress buster for COVID times. Now, when I wrote it, I had no idea about COVID or anything. COVID was not in the picture at all. COVID came along and gave the book a boost. You know, that people were reading it and recommending it, saying, you read this, if you're down, you should, you read it. And I have had people write to me, not write actually, I think it was in the comments, saying, one chap wrote saying that he wrote it when he had COVID and it helped him get better. So for me, that was very good. I mean, I felt very good that my book is actually helping people recover from COVID, helping people regain their good spirits during COVID and so on. So Tavishi, that's how it is for me. It was not particularly difficult because I did not look for any unusual identity, except that my books should generate humor, should make people smile at least, if not really laugh, sometimes smile. Now the travel book that I'm writing, I have just finished writing, it's also a fun travel book. Yeah. If you want to go on anything further, Tavishi, about the question that you asked?
No, ma'am. Yeah. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Next, I think Manvi would like to ask a question.
Yes.
Right, Manvi?
Good afternoon. Hi, Manvi. Ma'am.
Good afternoon.
Ma'am, I just wanted to ask you, like, how when we grow up in life, we lose the child inside ourselves, right?
We lose the child in ourselves. Yeah.
Yeah, kind of.
Mm.
And we become more sad and maybe more serious. And when you ask the person what happened, you used to be so, you know, lifelike. And they reply, life happened. So I'm going to ask you, after so much life which has happened to you in these spans of in these many span of years, how did you manage to preserve the child inside you and so much so that you created a world out of it?
Oh, that's a very nice question. I think to put it in a nutshell, you have now grown so old, but you still have the child in you, right? Yeah. So, yes, I think that is also because I've always tried to, it's not that I have not had my share of disasters, setbacks, and happiness and so on, which really makes you feel down at particular times. But maybe, you know, the child, there is this Nicholas Godstill who says, you know, in the storytelling animal, he says that the child in us never goes away, actually. It's always there. He says, we keep telling stories because that is the child in us, you know. We play out our childlike ways through dreams, through our dream world and so on. But anyway, the child is there. It is there in you, Manvi. It's very much there in you. It is there in all of us. If we read a book and laugh, it is because we are seeing, we find the humor in it. Some people will say, why are you laughing so much? Why are you behaving like a child? You know, almost as if they associate laughter with a child. No, you can always laugh anytime. Don't laugh without any reason. But when there is good reason, you have to laugh. So for me, it was, I enjoyed writing for children. I love children. All right. So and I try to forget this, whatever there are any setbacks and so on. When I was teaching in college, I have this ability to push things out of my mind. So when I'm going to teach, I may be very upset for whatever reason just before I enter class. But there is something about the classroom atmosphere, something about my students sitting there, something that makes me completely forget what has happened. I never allow it to affect how I am teaching. And then I get back to it. So I think that is what happens even when I'm writing. When I'm writing, it is I take on this garb of, you know, writing a fun book. I forget about everything. If there's a lot of noise around me, I just shut out noise. I'm very grateful for that ability to shut out things because one of my books was written when there was a renovation going on, and you won't believe the kind of noise that was there around me. How I wrote I think that was Clean Bowl Butterfingers. How I wrote that, I really do not know. But I wrote it because of this ability. So what I think is that when you meet children, again, they respond, the child in you responds to them. You just love to be with children. I love to be with children. I can understand. I think I can understand. I will not flaunt and say that I can understand. I'm really not too sure. But I think I can, to a certain extent, understand children and their behavior. See, I taught. I was on the other side, of course, which is what Shashi Tharoor said when he was releasing Gold Butterfingers, I think. He said, she's a teacher. She was on the other side. How does she understand? It's amazing how she understands how much. Understands the side, meaning the student side. How is she able to recapture their view of life, the way they behave, talk, and so on? But it is easy for me because I was a child once. It is not like I haven't gone through that stage. I have gone through that stage. Then I taught in a school for a couple of years, and then I taught in a college. So all this teaching experience has helped me a lot to find the child around. And therefore, and since for a child, humor is very important, it was easy for me to not to lose the child in me, to be like a child. You know, you have to, when you write, you should never talk down to children. You should be like them. They like my books because they say it is so much like how we are. So for me, that's the greatest compliment. They've even asked me, ma'am, how do you know how we think? How do you know this exactly, how things happen? How are you able to know that? I said, I really don't know how I know, but it's instinctive, you could say, because I have internalized all this. So Manvi, there's a child in you, and I hope that child will always come and help you along in life.
Thank you, ma'am. We just have one question from Pavan. Actually, he just messaged me. He wrote a haiku on the spot.
Oh, Pavan is the haiku. One more haiku. Good question.
It was not the hope, but I traveled on two boats while in teaching post. Was this the case when you began writing? Could you please? He just asked me to ask it to you on his behalf.
Can you read it again?
It was not the hope, but I traveled on two boats while in teaching post. I think he's mentioning
means is that when I was teaching, I was also writing. These were the two boats that I was traveling in, right? So was it meant to be that way?
No, he's asking, was this the case when you began writing?
Yeah, it was. Because when I was writing, I was in two boats. But these boats are kind of connected because writing is a lot to do with literature. I was teaching literature. I was not teaching science or any other subject. So I'm with books. I love books. I took literature. I had to fight quite a bit at home to take literature. You know how it is. Only two options, engineering, medicine. So if you have to take literature, you have to really say that, you know, you have to stand up for yourself and somehow convince people that this is your forte. So I did that. And I'm always with books, with literature, with what I love. With students teaching. So it was very easy for me to row two boats at the same time. But my writing was very quietly done. Many of my colleagues and friends didn't even know that I was writing because I kept it as a kind of a secret. See, teaching in a college it's very time consuming. In the sense, you need to prepare a lot, your lectures. And so work doesn't end in college. You go home. It's not now, of course, you're working 24/7 because the electronic noose is around your neck. But otherwise, you know, even otherwise, college teaching is a profession where you take your work home. You have to prepare. You have to do a lot of reading. Then evaluation, something that no teacher likes. That is happening all the time. So there are all these things that are simultaneously happening. So I was concentrating on all that because I love teaching. But I was also writing. I told you how I accidentally started writing that Butterfinger story. So from then on, I started writing. The writing bug bit me slowly, slowly, slowly. And I started writing. So it was happening simultaneously. And one was very obvious. The other was very quiet. So when I retired, I just switched gears. And I concentrated on my writing completely. Yeah. So Rohit, are you happy? I'm sorry, not Rohit. Who is
Pavan?
Pavan. Rohit is your head of the department. Okay, I just suddenly said.
Yes, ma'am. I have a question. That would you like to write a book wherein Butterfingers is stuck at home during the pandemic?
So many people ask me, is the next book going to be Butterfingers during the pandemic? Maybe it will be nice. It will be challenging actually to write. Because by the time the book comes out, we will really be living in a post-pandemic world. No? Your title would become true. So I would like to write such a book. I've not thought about it, or I've not thought seriously about it, Sneha, but let me see. Do you think it will be a good idea?
Yes, ma'am, of course.
Let's see. It will be challenging, actually. To write about a person like Butterfingers and lockdown and home, where do you get, you need to have some complication, right? Some mystery, something. So at home, what happens? I don't know. Let's see. Yeah.
So ma'am, I have a question.
Yeah. Muskan?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. We all have nice names. Muskan, Sneha, Smile.
Thank you, ma'am. Yes. Thank you so much, ma'am. Ma'am, my question is that since you spoke about teaching, so how has teaching affected in an online platform, especially in English literature? Like, what's your take on that?
See, I retired before this online thing happened. So I don't know what is it. I cannot tell you exactly how it is from firsthand experience. But I have my friends and former colleagues and a lot of people who have been telling me what online has done to teaching. I would say it's pretty disastrous. Nobody is happy with it. Nobody, not even students are not happy. teachers are not happy. For one thing, see, just when we were starting itself, you saw how we were not getting connectivity and so on. This is a problem that is a constant. You can't help it. No, it is because we are depending so much on technology. The first thing is, in a classroom, you see the teacher sees the student, and then there is an interaction, or maybe only the teacher talks and the student listens or whatever it is. But still, there's this physical presence. There is so much happening in the classroom. But when it is online, first of all, the frustrating thing for them is that the teachers say that they have to prepare and they give these lectures, and the students cannot hear them. They don't have connectivity. Then they are not interested, some of them. Class cutting happens when it's a physical class. You just cut class. There is a lot of joy and glamour in that, right? To cut class until you are caught and brought back. In my college, it used to be very strict. They used to round them up and bring them back, you know, all these people. And I'll tell them, if you don't want to be in class, stay away. So anyway, that is this. These children now, you don't have the videos on. So it is just the audio. You're there as a with your name alone. So the teachers say, we do not know whether they are there at all, whether they're listening at all. See, teaching is always, you need response from your students. It is the response that actually keeps you going. It is the response to your lecture that makes you want to go on with it. See, even now when I was talking to you, I was happy that there were two or three people whose faces I could see. Because otherwise it would have been only names for me. And that really helped me to see the response on the faces of people. That is what keeps you going. So when that is not there, you're talking to a screen. How much can you understand? How much you're not very confident that what you are saying is being accepted, is being understood, or if there is no give and take. You can put things in the chat box, but that's not quite like actually talking. So I will say there are a lot of limitations, Muskan. There are a lot of limitations with online teaching. So the teachers have a tough time. Students also have a tough time because they also are not able to attend at the right time. They're not able to. This connectivity majorly is a problem. So there are a lot of such issues that are there. But I would say that at least we have this. That is the way we can look at it. Had we not been so advanced and the pandemic had happened, what would we have done? We would have just been at home, teachers in their houses, students in their houses. We would have lost 2 years. So here, in some way, a kind of some classes were going on, lectures were happening, some kind of activity was happening with limited success, you could say, but something was happening. So I think we should be grateful for that. And I just hope, and even before this, the screen was being used quite a bit for PPT, you know, for presentations, all kinds of things. They were using the screen as an aid to your classes. It was only an aid, but now it became everything. The screen became all in all. So that is when the difficulty also started. But I would say that we let's look at it this way. This is something in such a scenario, we were forced into this. Nobody was prepared. Also, the limitations are because of unpreparedness. Had teachers known we were going to go online, had students known that we are going to have online teaching and taken the necessary training and had the necessary equipment and so on, then things would have been much better. This is like just dumping people into the water and saying swim. So you're forced to swim. You're forced to do something. So when all these constraints were there, the fact that we have done so much is something we should be happy about. I think we should be proud of the fact that we managed this much. My only fear is once we go back to normal, this does not become the new normal. There are lots of offices which are planning to make this the new normal, which is not a nice thing at all. So that is a little bit of a fear that teachers can just say that we will have online classes tomorrow. We won't have classes in college. No, you should not have those kind of things. I do not know how things will turn out once the pandemic is over. But I think you should also be happy that you have watched this happen. how many have done that, you know, down the ages. If you look at it, you are experiencing something unique. So, Muskan, you can smile and think later that I actually lived through this period. I actually studied through this period. I actually, you know, had part of my education during such trying times. So I think let's look at it that way, because I wouldn't want to categorically say it was good or bad or ugly, but it was just that it was something that was necessary. Can't even call it a necessary evil. It was, it became necessary, and we did the best of a bad job, you could say. We managed, and we can all pat ourselves on the back to say that we have come out of it rather unscathed. Let's wait and see till we completely emerge out, and hope that we can put this behind us and go back to our old method of, you know, classes and so on. And maybe take something from here too. Let's not forget this completely. The uses of online teaching. You know, some of the good things we should take with us. Yes. So that's fine, Sneha. And Muskan, you're okay with it? You have anything else?
I'm sure. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Anubha, ma'am.
Yeah. Thank you.
No, no. So, I just postponed my video to make myself visible to this.
Ma'am, I was thinking because they were talking about teaching. So.
Yeah, I am so glad that she mentioned this. And she being a teacher and an author makes so much of sense. That we are constantly teaching a silent, the Professor Karunisa,
yes.
I call it a silent scream that I have to do every day.
Yeah,
and then, most often there is no response on the other side.
Yeah, it must be so frustrating. I've
either fallen asleep to my monotonous drawl or you know, whatever.
Yeah, I know, I can totally understand. You know, I'm so glad I'm not teaching at this time. I'm sorry, but you are, but...
but yeah, this you coming into our classroom only reiterates what we have been going through and reiterates in a much more simpler fashion. And nothing could be better than being a children's writer. I suppose this is one of those higher innocences that an adult chooses to write children's fiction. And one needs that kind of a higher innocence. Having gone through all kinds of pandemics, personal and the global pandemics, to be able to do so. So glad to have you in the classroom. I was in fact thinking of when you were reciting the nursery rhyme, T.S. Eliot's nursery rhyme, which he uses in Hollow Men.
Yeah.
And he says, here we go round the prickly pear, which is here we go round the mulberry bush.
Mulberry bush, yeah.
Yeah. And but the trauma of it and the angst of it, which you get to read in T.S. Eliot's here we go round the prickly pear, is the pain that people are going through in the pandemic, and for young people to be able to cope with it, of course we need literature in the classroom, we need books like this in the classroom. I had one small question, and this question was to do with how we have grown up with the tradition of reading comics, whether it's Tintin's comics or Dennis the Menace, and marveled at them and been smitten with them.
Yeah.
But now very serious novels are getting written in the graphic novel tradition. Yes. And so how do you see this animated characters who can bring in humor to the classroom? And animated is also virtual in a certain sense. It's beyond the real. So. Yeah. Butterfingers is an ideal character whom you would want to keep creating joy. Yeah. In the graphic novel tradition also, we have moved into... how do you see this this tradition of the comic strip or the graphic novel or the just the text written? My kids have to read these tomes of classics like Madame Bovary in Tom or Warren. <Yeah. laughs>
They would love to read it in the comic strip form. I'm
absolutely, absolutely.
We used to have classics illustrated. You remember long back?
Yeah. I wish they came back, and even for the elderly. They are looking for illustrated books, and I was telling my mother, let me look for them because they are available abroad.
Yeah.
So, what about this transition?
Yeah, I think Yeah, because I think what you said is right, because we all love looking at pictures. See, that's how we first started. Before reading books, we looked at pictures. So the pictorial element, you know, we really respond to pictures. And that is probably why, even as grown-ups, when we look at, when we see a book, we look at the cover, we look at the pictures. If there are some illustrations in between, we look at that. Because we love that. But there's the other side, which says that it is people with limited concentration, powers of concentration, who like comics. They can't give their complete attention to a book. See, the book swallows you up. It's a it's very quiet, sedate. You need to concentrate. So many demands are made on you when you're reading a book. But when you're reading a comic, you know, it's a kind of a page turner. You look at that's why I was talking about how sad I felt when my story was turned into a comic strip. But because what they put in the panels are what they call those squares. So what they put in the panels would only be conversation that is necessary for the plot. So they will put what is funny. They will bring in what takes the plot forward. So only that which is most exciting is there. It is almost like we might lose our readers if we make it lengthy. They have a short attention span. So I don't like this actually, catering to people because of what they are. Why don't we make them read books and, you know, have a better attention span? Why? Because they have this short attention span, should we have microfiction and, you know, all this kind of thing? So we have to change the way people think. Instead of that, we are producing something, we are bringing on something that caters to the consumer, you could say, the reader who is a consumer. So you have now graphic novels. In fact, my editor was also saying how the graphic novels are now becoming popular because people don't have the patience to read for complete books. I find that very sad when I hear that. I'm really sad. My books, my Butterfingers may have come in comics, and I love comics too, but I don't love them. It's not a substitute for reading a book. It's a different
thing. Absolutely. Yeah. Glad you highlight that. And how do you even suggest any tips for the younger generation, since you say that you love the children and you often spend time with them? What would you suggest? How do we even create this habit of reading? It's very difficult. Students enroll for it.
I know.
Refuse to read the text.
Yeah, it's and very, very challenging. Yeah, I know. Yeah. And we have too many distractions, right? Now what we find is they've got too many distractions around. But I would still say the old method still helps. That is, a child must, the house must have books. There must be an atmosphere of books in the house. The child must see books around. And the child must also see see their parents reading. You can't ask a child to read a book while you are looking into the phone or while you are watching some match on television. So they are imitating us all the time. The children always imitate us. They want to do what the older person is doing. So you have to set an example without making the child, this is where you have to be really smart about it, without making the child realize that you are doing it to get the child to read. It should all happen in a very spontaneous, natural way. So absolutely, the child enjoys reading. You could read to the child. You could tell the child half a story and leave it at the very interesting part and conveniently leave the book open at that part. The child might take up the book and read. So this is how my son started reading. He was not reading. I was getting a little alarmed because our house was full of books. We are reading books, but he's not reading books. He wants me to tell him stories. So when he was in the fourth standard, okay, and he was not well, I was reading. I remember the book I was reading. I was reading Castle of Adventure to him. I must have been doing such a shoddy job that he just plugged the book from my hand and started reading.
Wow.
Yeah.
You remember the moment when your child begins to read.
Yeah, awesome. I was so thrilled, and he hasn't stopped. He's a chronic reader now. So I always tell people, don't despair if your child doesn't read when he's in the second standard, third standard, or third grade, whatever. Never give up. They can start anytime.
So we have hope even with our English honors students. They will start at the age of 18, 19.
Yeah, I'm sure you have hope, Dr. Anubha. I'm sure it's all, it's in your hands. It's a challenge.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Anyway, such a joy talking to all of you. Thank you so much.
Same here. And Dr. Pramesh, Sneha, how do you want to conclude? How do you want to, do you have still questions or do you want Dr. Pramesh to come in? Dr. Jaini, whoever, Dr. Lalit, Dr. Rohit?
And we can have Rohit sir, Pramesh sir, and the other professors come
allow
in.
Allow me to say that this is a wonderful talk because we have someone here who's a natural optimist. She had the inborn gift of laughter and she's sharing it with the world, and that's just wonderful. I'm not going to hold forth because this is about you guys, so you guys just take over now. And only thing I have to say, thank you very much for bringing good cheer to all of us.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pramesh.
Yeah, I would also like to just say one thing. You know, when we when Sneha came up with this idea of this lecture series, we readily said yes to it. But then, they wrote to several people, but Professor Khairunnisa was the first one to say yes. So, that is it, got it going. And then, we had many people saying yes to us, people like Dr. Shashi Tharoor, Professor Rajiv Malhotra, Ruby Kaur, who else, Sneha? I think KK Shailaja.
Yes, sir.
We realized we could go with the lecture series just because she said yes. Had she said no, maybe, we would have kind of disappointed and frustrated and might have, we can't say for sure, but your yes kind of got it going, and
thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
So and it was wonderful listening to you, a very inspiring kind of a talk, as the professor said, full of optimism, and I think it will really, we are on our way to paradise.
So thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thanks so much. And thank you for giving me this opportunity to meet all of you. Even though it's online, I hope someday we can actually meet.
Yeah, ma'am. Sure.
Yeah. So thank you. Thank you very much. And have a great day. And let's hope we will go towards world that is a little like paradise.
Ma'am. Pooja ma'am also has raised her hand. So we'd end after that.
Yes, Dr. Pooja, thank you. I have to thank you for keeping your video on because I was all constantly looking at you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. It was indeed an amazing session, and not just for being like, I enjoyed it thoroughly, not just being a listener, not just being a teacher, but also as a mother. Because, I don't want to spend much time, but I would like to share what happened yesterday. Yesterday, as like Sneha, I shared with Sneha as well. Yesterday was my daughter's birthday. And I thought of gifting her a membership of British Council Library, a place where I spend a lot of time, as a student, I would often, particularly a student of literature, I would. But then now, she's 9 years old, ma'am.
Okay.
She turned. So what happened was I was trying to find out because, the field, the point you were talking about, books being the best friend, and, books is one, habit of reading book, though it is difficult to inculcate. But yes, it has a lot of advantages, not just in terms of being, in the material world, but, widening the horizons or the thinking capacity and lot many things. But, one of the onslaughts of Corona thing is many of the things have gone the digital way. So I wanted actually, you know, she to have the access to library where she goes, and she at least once a month, she goes there, spends 1 or 2 hours there, and then looks around at the books available and pick up the books which she feels like. Superimpose on her, you know, impose on her. But like one of the, and you know, you were also talking about certain things we would like to do the moment this in the post or the AC time, you know, the after corona time. I suppose that is also going to be one of the things, you know, when things come back to the offline mode, and I'm sure many of our students would also be craving for that time, you know, the offline mode, the real experience, as you also pointed out, the live concert, attending something which is live. So, I mean, though I have a lot of things to say, and I'm sure many, all of us, you know, enjoyed it, but I enjoyed your session thoroughly. How would you like to, ma'am, a little short tip in Anubha, ma'am talked about, you know, a tip which you can give to the young learners, particularly, like the teenagers or, you know, anything would you like to share with us, a quick tip?
Tip for youngsters.
Yeah, youngsters. Hanji.
Well, I would like them to keep their eyes and ears open and see how the world is, you know, take in what the world is, because very often you are not looking at what is happening around you. You're looking at the screen all the time. So I would like them to not allow life to pass them by and enjoy the world and keep reading. I can't help but say that. Please enjoy the world through books too. So that's what I would like them to do.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Yes, so I leave you. Thank you. Have a nice
lunch. Yes, ma'am. We have a vote of thanks planned as well. So sorry for keeping you. I mean, Nandana, please go ahead.
Thank you, ma'am, for your insightful words.
Ms. Nandana, thank you also for keeping your video on. You, Sneha.
My pleasure, ma'am.
Manvi, yeah. All of you, I think, kept the video on. And Muskan occasionally.
Hi, Nandana Pia, Vice President of ZEST, Department of English, Deen Dayal Upadhyay College, University of Delhi. Deem it a great honor and privilege to be here today for second session of our Distinguished Lecture Series 2021 on Post-Pandemic World, Pandemonium to Paradise. We have learned a great deal and are indebted to our speaker, Professor Khairun Nizam, ma'am, who despite her busy schedule has managed to find time for this event and have inspired each one of us with her words. We hope to enjoy every moment of our lives like smash it butterfingers. Thank you so much, ma'am. I would like to thank our teacher in charge, Dr. Rohit B, and all the faculty members. In addition to that, I'm expressing my overwhelmed gratitude to each and every single person who has managed to find time to attend this event. Last but not the least, I would like to thank the ZEST team, who has undoubtedly worked so hard to make this event a successful one. Once again, thank you all. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, each one of you. Thank you very much. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bye, ma'am. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.